Hi everyone, hope you're doing well. Today we will be discussing Laurence, Bergenworth scholar and founder of the Healing Church. While Maria's story tells a tale of sorrow and letting go, Laurence's journey is one of unbridled ambition and eventually regret. Any regular person playing through Bloodborne would naturally assume that the narrative we experience is our own, but from my point of view, Bloodborne is really Laurence's story. Everything we see and everything we witness can be traced back to Laurence, to his choice to leave Bergenworth and found the Healing Church. Let's start at the beginning. The description of the Tomb Prospector set reads, "The Healing Church traces its roots to Bergenworth and is therefore aware of the ruins' true importance. Bergenworth, the ruins, and the Healing Church. This is the bedrock upon which all the events in Bloodborne sit. When Laurence was a young man, he was a scholar at Bergenworth, and a confidant of Master Willem's. Personally, I believe that Laurence may have been brilliant, but he lived in the shadow of Willem, wishing to make his own mark on the world, craft his own institution that would allow him to make his own name as venerated as Willem's. This ambition, this drive for greatness, would eventually lead to Laurence's downfall and torment." When we ask Alfred, the executioner, about Bergenworth, he says the following.
"Bergenworth is an old place of learning, and the Tomb of the Gods, carved out below Yharnam, should be familiar to every hunter. Well, once a group of young Bergenworth scholars discovered a holy medium deep within the tomb. This led to the founding of the Healing Church and the establishment of blood healing."
It is unknown how exactly Willem, Laurence, and perhaps a handful of others accessed the first of the tombs or chalice dungeons as we know them. I've spoken in the past how I believe that places like the giant sanctuary in the Forbidden Woods and the gorge in front of Canehurst Castle may be physical entrances to the dungeons, places that skip the need for a holy chalice and instead just require the manpower to breach the outer walls of the labyrinth. Alternatively, the entrance may be near to the aptly named Tomb of Urden. I say this partly because of what Alfred says and is what is said in the description of the formless Urden rune. Alfred describes the event in which Laurence and the others discovered a holy medium within the tomb. I was unsure what this medium was for quite a while, until I started searching for where else the word medium appears again in the game. The description of the formless Urden rune reads, "The Great One Urden, lacking form, exists only in voice, and is symbolized by this rune. Those who memorize it enjoy a larger supply of quicksilver bullets. Human or no, the oozing blood is a medium of the highest grade, and the essence of the formless Great One Urden. Both Urden and his inadvertent worshippers surreptitiously seek the precious blood." So, the old blood is a medium of the highest grade, and is the essence of Urden. I believe that it is possible that the Tomb of Urden, the area where we face Gascoigne, might be a former entrance to one of the dungeons. I say this because of how the center statue actually sits in the area. It looks sunken, leaning to one side. I think this may be due to the center statue being built on soft earth that has given way over time. This is the same reason why the Tower of Pisa leans. See, since the rest of Yharnam seems to be built quite solidly, it's odd that this element sticks out, and may imply that below the statue lies soft ground, or a pit. Personally, I believe that it's possible that this is where the first excavations may have been made, either that or in the Forbidden Woods. It would not be too far of a jump in logic to assume that when the old blood was discovered, Willem was already an established and celebrated intellectual, but Laurence was more than likely yet to make any great discoveries of his own, at least until the discovery of the blood. Laurence would see this as his opportunity to make his mark, and no one would take that away from him, not even Willem. It would not take long for Willem and Laurence to come to disagreements over whether or not the blood should be used for the benefit of mankind. Presumably Willem and Laurence began some early experimentation to discover that while the blood had incredible effects, it most likely had hidden, possibly malevolent side effects. Bergenworth developed an adage that Willem and Laurence would both remember in their own way.
"We are born of the blood. Made men by the blood, undone by the blood. Our eyes are yet to open. Fear the old blood."
Clearly, Willem respects the blood. but also fears what mass application of such a force would have on a larger population. Willem had the foresight to know that whatever actions Laurence would take, they would most likely end in tragedy. Regardless of this, Willem would allow Laurence to leave Bergenworth to pursue his success, but also stayed mindful of what could happen.
By the gods, fear it, Laurence.
And so, Laurence would travel to Yharnam, possibly with several scholars that agreed with him on his views on the Blood. It's possible that Amelia was among these, as well as Yuri, Edgar, Carol, Archibald, Mikalash, Gehrman, and possibly Maria, though that is debatable. Since Gehrman and Maria are not the focus here, let's just stick to the scholars for now. In terms of the Healing Church, I do not believe that Yharnam became the city we know overnight. What is more likely is that Laurence and his scholars set up small blood clinics initially, selling the blood in vials as a cure-all. Motivation for taking the blood to Yharnam might stem from the possibility that Yharnam was already experiencing a plague of sorts. Part of the description of the ailing Loran chalice reads, "The tragedy that struck this ailing land of Loran is said to have its roots in the scourge of the beast." In other words, Loran was a land in poor health before blood healing became a common practice. It is only after use of the blood when manners grew out of control. I don't think it's a stretch to put forth the idea that Yharnam was in a similar position and required blood healing as a desperate last solution. If we take this hypothetical a bit further, Laurence and his compatriots would be seen as the saviors of their city if they actually managed to stave off a plague with their blood healing. The old blood did not only heal the body, however, but most likely became an addiction for many Yharnamites. It is said in the description of the pungent blood cocktail that, "In Yharnam, they produce more blood than alcohol, as the former is more intoxicating." It would seem that blood began as a medicinal tool, but soon grew out of its initial usage and instead became a replacement for many vices, creating a very lucrative business. This could almost be compared to the practice of morphine in the early 1900s. However, I do not believe that Laurence would have been among the types to exploit the blood in this way. You are obviously free to interpret Laurence in whatever way you would like to, but I believe that, as Laurence was one of the first people to discover the blood, he understood and did fear the blood to an extent. Regardless of this, Laurence's destruction and his loss of control of the church were rapidly approaching. Before the fall of Yharnam, and before the Nightmare for that matter, the Healing Church would enjoy more success and more dependency from the inhabitants of the city. Presumably, the Cathedral Ward was constructed or reappropriated by the Healing Church as a base of central administration as well as residential areas. While some inhabitants of Cathedral Ward sound sarcastic or strange in regard to their admiration of the Healing Church, it seems to be complimentary all the same, if a bit weird.
Praise you! Praise the old damn church! And then the best of luck, Hudson! Best luck of all!
Oh, we've the deepest gratitude for the church and all they do for us. The deepest, widest gratitude, yes. Yes.
Laurence would be made first vicar of the church and would head the leadership hierarchy for a time. He would appoint others to be vicars, like Amelia. What is difficult about talking about this point in time is when exactly other factions would come into play, such as the executioners, the powder kegs, the choir, the black and white church hunters, and so on. As I've discussed before in the Ludwig video, the official church hunters came into use only after the majority of the old hunters and Gehrman were sent to the hunter's dream, to fill the vacant spot. That's what Ludwig's job was. We can understand that, at least. I believe that the choir came into power after Laurence was imprisoned in the Nightmare, but we are getting ahead of ourselves here. It would be at this time when blood healing became a staple of Yharnam, and most likely led to the city becoming a beacon of hope to those who had suffered without any hope of recovery. For a period of time, we can assume things were fine. Beasthood might have been unheard of for a while. Unfortunately, however, the side effects of the imbibing of blood must have become apparent. What we can tell from the old hunters, the earliest iterations of Yharnam hunters, is just about anyone in Yharnam with combat experience was recruited to fight beasts. The efforts would have been very disorganized, and prevention against beasthood were methods that proved that the old hunters had very little knowledge about the scourge. They would adorn their armor with pieces of brass in acts of superstition, and their weapons were little more than repurposed farming tools improved by Gehrman. The descriptions of the old hunter clothing also references them as being 10 a penny, implying that there were many in number and cheap to hire. In the old hunter's absence, Ludwig and his holy blades would take up arms against the beasts, which is something I talked about at length in the Ludwig video. The church was slowly changing from an institution of aid to a militarized force, further from Lawrence's vision that he had ever anticipated. The beast scourge, as we know it in Bloodborne, would only become a reality after the events in Old Yharnam, however, and would change both Lawrence and the healing church forever.
Yes, very good. I no longer dream. But I was once a hunter too. There's nothing more horrific than a hunt. In case you fail to realize, the things you hunt, they're not beasts. They're people.
The timeline regarding Old Yharnam is difficult to pin down, to say the least. By all accounts, it occurred long ago. The description of the antidote item reads, "The ashen blood ailment eventually triggered the spread of the beastly scourge." I take this to mean that the mysterious ashen blood illness acted as a catalyst for the beasthood to spread to the rest of Yharnam, and caused the church to take drastic measures. Now, it can be debated as to whether Lawrence was still present in Yharnam at this time, but I believe he was. After all, if he were just imbibing blood itself, would that be enough to imprison him in the Hunter's Nightmare? Well, what about genocide? Would that be enough? There is a note that can be found in central Yharnam that reads, "When the hunt began, the healing church left us, blocking the great bridge to Cathedral Ward as Old Yharnam burned to the ground that moonlit night." If Lawrence was still present as First Vicar, it would have been his responsibility to act on what was occurring in Old Yharnam, and I believe it's perfectly reasonable to believe that Old Yharnam was cleansed on his orders as a desperate and regrettable action. Jura and his compatriots would have descended into Old Yharnam, burning everything in sight on orders to kill any beasts, half-transformed or otherwise. Lawrence could watch Old Yharnam burn from the Cathedral Ward, numb to the suffering of so many. After this event, Yharnam would begin to see the church for what it was, an institution that was rotten and unafraid to kill their own congregation if the need was great enough. Lawrence, I believe, was now blood drunk by proxy, as his actions had led to the deaths of so many. Moreover, Lawrence would have now been aware of the dangers of imbibing the old blood. JSF, a fantastic Bloodborne lore enthusiast, has made a video regarding Lawrence during this period, which I recommend that all of you go and watch, as my beliefs about what happened next to Lawrence are very similar to JSF's, and I just want to make sure that credit is given to him for his work. I will link his video in the description below. JSF theorizes that Lawrence may have performed the act of bloodletting, or purposefully letting himself bleed, as a way of expelling beast blood. The description of the bloodletter reads, "The bloodletter assumes its true and terrifying form after it draws upon blood from the inner reaches of one's body and soul. This is the only effective means of expelling tainted blood," or so Braedor, isolated in his cell, continued to believe. Braedor, who we will be discussing soon, carried the belief that bloodletting was a viable method of reversing one's beasthood. Could this have been a belief held by Lawrence as well? It's possible. Make no mistake, Lawrence did eventually turn into a beast, but the method in which this happened is very debatable. Personally, I believe that Lawrence tried to avoid becoming a beast for a long time, taking measures to stop the process. The Beast's Embrace rune has a description that reads, After repeated experiments in controlling the scourge of beasts, the gentle Embrace rune was discovered. This rune allows one to turn into a beast of their own free will, and the physical appearance of this beasthood closely resembles that of the bloodletting beast, a boss in the Chalice Dungeons. One theory that has been quite prevalent over time is that the bloodletting beast is Laurence. One might ask, how can the bloodletting beast be Laurence? Laurence already appears as a fiery cleric beast in the Old Hunters DLC. That's right, he does. JSF has a rationale for this, which we will get to later. The bloodletting beast's face has a more primate appearance, while the cleric beast honestly seems to be a cross between a strange wolf and a bird. If we look at the skull of Laurence in the Grand Cathedral, it definitely appears to be more primate-like. One must remember also that the bloodletting beast has a very large gash over its back. This is important in relation to Braedor. I'd like to state up front that both JSF's and Redgrave's interpretations of Braedor and his relationship to Laurence have made an impression on me, and much of my inferences on this matter stem from their original theses. Descriptions of Braedor's set read: the scalp of a horrible cleric beast, indicating that Hunter Braedor, a healing church assassin, had killed a compatriot. Afterward, he wore his ally's own scalp and hid himself away deep below in a cell. The church provided him with a single, soundless bell of death to ensure their secrets would be kept. The bloodied hide of a horrible cleric beast pulled over the back. Without the attached beast hide, this foreign garb wouldn't raise anyone's eyebrows. Braedor donned a compatriot's beastly scalp and hide while still moist with blood. Most of the bloodstains on this hide were from that day. Again, this theory comes from JSF, but I believe that it is credible. He states that Braedor actually killed Laurence, scalping his ally and wearing his remains as a reminder of his betrayal. Braedor may have entered the nightmare willingly, accepting his fate. The beast that was slain was perhaps the bloodletting beast, the headless version that is found in the Ehiel Chalice Dungeon. It lacks a head and part of the hide, and considering that Laurence's skull is in the cathedral, it might have been decapitated as well. JSF puts forth the concept that the parasite that lives inside the bloodletting beast may actually be controlling the body, which is an interesting idea to say the least. I'd now like to answer the question as to why Laurence appears in the DLC, and why he is a cleric beast. The explanation to this is actually quite obvious, at least to me, as I buy into JSF's interpretation. A person can be alive in the dreamlands, but dead in the real world. Mikalash, for instance, is dead in the real world, as we can see from his mummy, but lives in the nightmare of Mensis. Maria is likewise dead in the real world, most likely buried at the workshop, yet is alive in the astral clock tower. And so, Laurence is dead in the real world, but lives on in a tortured state within the Hunter's nightmare, a fiery, tormented cleric beast. Part of JSF's theory as to why Laurence is a cleric beast and not a bloodletting beast is that one's appearance in the Dreamlands is only one's mental projection of oneself. A decent analogy of this would be how Neo appears inside the Construct during the first Matrix film. In the real world, he is bold, malnourished, and weak, but in the Construct he has hair, is healthy, and agile. Maria's mental projection of herself is her in her hunter's garb, wielding her Rakuyo, and even though it is said that she previously discarded her weapon, she still has it. Laurence's mental image is that of a beast in fiery agony, with the type of beast that he is remaining unimportant. Again, JSF goes into more detail on that front. The point is, Laurence became imprisoned in the dream and slumbers in the Grand Cathedral. The description of Laurence's skull reads, "Skull of Laurence, first vicar of the Healing Church. In reality, he became the first cleric beast, and his human skull only exists within the nightmare. The skull is a symbol of Laurence's past and what he failed to protect. He is destined to seek his skull, but even if he found it, it could never restore his memories. This skull of Laurence, which sits upon the church's holy shawl, is an object of torment. It is said that he looks for his skull, but the act itself is fruitless, as he will remain a beast regardless of whether he locates his human skull or not. Laurence's callousness, his unbridled ambition, his quest for greatness would lead him to the heights of success and also the depths of despair. Any plans he made to improve Yharnam would be squandered by his own inability to grasp the consequences of his actions. As it is often said, the road to hell is paved with good intentions." I want to pause for a moment to discuss the etymology of Laurence's name. Laurence is derived from the ancient Roman city Laurentum, but I find it more interesting to analyze he who shares the name, Saint Laurence of Rome. Just as Laurence was the first vicar of the Healing Church, St. Laurence was made first deacon, the Archdeacon of Rome, by Pope Sixtus II. In 258 AD, Emperor Valerian delivered an edict that all members of the church under Sixtus must be put to death. This is not particularly unheard of during this time, as Christians, proto-Christians, and all other sects were often persecuted for their beliefs. Laurence was ordered by the prefect of Rome to gather all of the church's wealth and hand it over to the emperor. Laurence said he would play along, but had other plans. In 3 days, Laurence gave all the gold of the church to the poor and ailing of Rome instead, and then presented himself alongside the masses of poor to the prefect, stating that these were the true treasures of the church. Laurence would be seized and given a martyr's death. How exactly was St. Laurence killed, you may ask? Well, he was put on a metal gridiron and burned to death slowly. He retained a sense of humour, reportedly saying during his execution, "I'm done on this side, you can turn me over now." Does this ring a bell to how we discover Laurence in the DLC, hunched over a metal statue burning for eternity? I'll let you decide. I think we'll wrap it up there for this episode. Laurence has always been one of my favourite characters, so I was more than happy to get into this investigation. His tale is largely speculative in terms of timeline, so I encourage you to form your own ideas and let me know about them. I can always be contacted via Twitter or the Facebook page, and things have been very, very hectic the last couple of weeks, and I'm finding it difficult to commit a lot of time to YouTube, even though I am trying, believe me. As always, let me know if you like the video or not, and I'll see you next time.